in general, supercell mesocyclones, to me, fit this diagram, which goes all the way back to a Lemon and Doswell paper back in the late 70s that talks about a mesocyclone in the mid-levels that is more of a traditional Rankine-type solid body vortex that's rotating up there. But down in the low levels, it's more of a bifurcated situation where you've got inflow coming in and wrapping around while you have RFD things wrapping around the other side. And so the circulation that we see down low is actually the two airstreams passing each other. And it sets, and it's all brought about by the mid-level mesocyclone and then stuff that I know Rich talked to you about with the pressure perturbations and making it all happen. But there's actually, to me, it's easier for me to think of two separate processes going on. I can keep it a little straighter in my mind when I look at the radar data. There was one thing that was really cool about the Lemon and Doswell papers that they really got into some of this stuff before they really had a ton of data to work with. And I think that's just another important thing to point out, that as you guys research things, don't automatically throw out anything pre-2005. I think there are still things like this written in 1979, and Ari Lexton, like say, he was picking on you guys early and talking about, oh, he was in third grade when he became MIC or something. I think I was in high school when this paper was written. There's still really cool stuff that goes on here. And I think trying to understand what you see on the radar in terms of this makes some sense to me. I'll show you some examples here in a little bit. I like this one from a standpoint of pulling the old in with the new. This is a storm over Tulsa. You've got low level reflectivity 0.5 again in the upper left. You've got ZDR over here in the upper right, so we're a little bit above the freezing level, so we're looking for ZDR columns. Why would you have liquid raindrops above freezing? That's because that's where the updraft is. The beware is marked there in the lower right, and you can see the beware that has the red square in it is the Gibson Ridge red square that helps you make sure that everything's geosynced up. And the mesocyclone center at that higher altitude is in the center of the beware. So it all kind of makes sense that the updraft from the ZDR is exactly where the beware is, which is exactly where the center of the mesocyclone is, and it all makes sense. It's kind of cool. In the Lemon and Doswell paper, they predict at some point that the mesocyclone will actually move up shear of the beware, and it's during this time period is when the rear flank downdraft is likely to start to descend. You don't see many papers written like this anymore. I don't know that I've really seen this quoted much, but it actually worked out real well in this case, where you can see the mesocyclone has shifted to the southwest of the red square there, which marks the beware. The hook's still kind of raggedy, but it's there. But the RFD is coming now. The next scan, you can see the hook suddenly rapidly formed. And the storm is on the verge of making a tornado. This is what the rotational velocity looked like over time, just to show you how quickly it finally went in the last few minutes, where we went from kind of struggling to all of a sudden you've got deep, stronger rotational velocity, and eventually you have the tornado form. And I've seen this little pause too, and I don't have a good thought of that, so you can quiz your instructors on this later, where the mesocyclone seems to be going along, it's deepening, coming down, and all of a sudden there's a pause. It seems weaker, and then the next time you see it again, it's intensifying. I've seen that pause before, and sometimes that can throw you off as a warning forecast, or you can let your guard down for a second. But in this case, if you were looking at the other stuff aloft, you would have anticipated the RFD coming down, and maybe that was the beginning of it. Here's the TDWR data from that case, just so you can see how fast that all came together. And you also show off radar data in black and white is still cool. You can see things sometimes, at least to my eye, I can see structures and I can see things happen without having my eyes so loaded with the color scale. Repeat it again, because it's pretty cool. But we went from kind of struggling little storm to all of a sudden it just flew around. It quickly made a tornado. The environment was only, the favorable environment was only as wide as you see it right there. Quickly the tornado dissipated once it got out of Broken Arrow and it was done. But that was another one of these cases where the near storm environment pointed towards something like that trying to happen. I wanted to quickly mention QLCS tornadoes, because section one here is like, we hate them. No one likes them. They embarrass you. They cause people to fuss. But they happen. I think there's lots of definitions. One thing is not called a gustnado like you see called on some media outlets. They're not gustnados. QLCS tornadoes are part of the thunderstorm, So it's something with a connection that's being vented through the thunderstorm cell itself, where a gust NATO is just out on the gust front by itself, something lower end. EF or QLCS tornadoes can reach EF3 in intensity. We've had EF2 tornadoes in the Tulsa forecast area that have been QLCS tornadoes. They can be EF3, so they're not necessarily brief. They're not necessarily weak. They can be pretty significant. I tell our office, don't shadow box with them, don't guess at them, don't light up the whole line, but if you think you got one and you think you understand what's going on, certainly put out a tornado warning for it. The 0 to 3 kilometer shear is very important in understanding that. You can anticipate this some. We've noticed that if the 0 to 3 kilometer shear is more than 30 knots and it starts to be, especially if it's perpendicular, but if it starts to be something more than 45 degrees in an angle to the line of the storms, it's getting more important. The QLCS thing that spun up in Louisiana yesterday, if you all were watching the radar, the 0 to 3 kilometer shear was starting to go past 45 degrees. So it wasn't truly at 90, but it was starting to go past 45. And right when that happened, that's when that strong QLCS spun up, and that's when the TDS flared up from that one tornado that was in the line. You can anticipate this some. These aren't just totally mysterious things that just suddenly go, oh my gosh, what happened? The 0 to 3 kilometer shear in that configuration holds the gust front back, and so it keeps the gust front underneath the updraft, and that's what you want. You want that vortex sheet to spin up where it can be vented by the cell itself and not just something that's rolling out on the gusty winds out ahead of it. So these can be anticipated. You can get acceptable at this. Now, you'll never catch the warning. By the time you see it, it will already be doing damage. I mean, it's a process that happens basically at or near the surface. By the time you can recognize it, you've already missed it. But then you go on, do I go ahead and continue the warning because there could be another one? Those become really tough decisions at some point. This is a storm. You can see the QLCS storm to the east of Fort Smith, and you can see it's got the little reflectivity hook. We call it elephant trunk in the office because it sort of, especially when it really wraps up, kind of looks like an elephant trunk. The circulation is here. The ground survey from this event is this. We did our normal ground survey. We tried to mark the vectors of which way things fell. Then I scanned the map and went back and just put pencil to paper and try to draw out streamlines with it. But you can see a confluent pattern right there. You can see where there's convergence, and it's a narrow enough convergence, and the damage was significant. It was a decent EF1 tornado. And so we could pick out damage that looked like tornado damage underneath the couplet, underneath the little hook. So we do know that at times those are real tornadoes. Sometimes I think QLCS circulations are bigger than we think. I think this one's a really cool one. This is going over Broken Arrow. And the TDWR there is in north side of Broken Arrow. But I just wanted to call your attention to the hydrometeors being pulled in up here. These little showers are passing in front of the squall line. As this one got up here, and as this QLCS circulation intensified, notice how it stripped some of the raindrops off and pulled it back in here. If you actually went from the bottom of down here where it looks like that's where the southern extent of the influence of the QLCS is, and come up here, we're talking many miles. It's not a tiny little mesocyclone thing that's all quick spin up and whatever. They actually can dominate the circulation within many miles of them. I think they all come, there's a continuum of them just like anything else. I think there's some that border more looking like supercell circulations, or some that look more just like gust fronty things. But the bottom line is you don't often know what they're going to be. And I think there are times that they're more important than we think. Good, last couple things here, scale matters. Just on the Big Cape days, the mesocyclones often begin to organize higher than you think. This time of year, 4,000 feet, maybe you're looking at stuff. And stuff higher than that, and you're like, yeah, it's too high, you know, whatever. But as we get into the bigger Cape days, we get into the latter part of spring, sometimes those mesocyclones don't really begin to show themselves until they're higher up. And sometimes that's easy to dismiss and say, I've got increasing mesocyclone organization at 10,000 feet. Like, well, okay, nobody lives at 10,000 feet. Well, in the high Cape days, it all works, because it's like comparing that's me and Ed Calanese, the WCM from the Tulsa office, next to some ginormous basketball player. If you were just going to do a knee examination on the basketball player and just measure the distance from the floor up to his knee and then took that same measurement to me, you'd be looking at a different part of my body. So it's the same thing with the storms. If the storm is now 70,000 or 60,000 feet tall or whatever it is, you got to expect it to be scaled differently than a storm that was 30,000 feet. So where these circulations show up in the vertical, it matters, and it matters to the depth of the storm. So I just point this out real quick on hail, since not everything is all tornadoes, and of course that's mostly what we talked about, but I noticed that if the 0 to 6 kilometer shear is less than 15 knots, the hail probably doesn't make it to the ground, or at least it underperforms what you think it should be at the radar. I like reflectivity of the minus 20, knowing the shear, and knowing if there's a mesocyclone in there. If you can give me those three things, I can guess hail size to some degree. And actually, you know, that's the shear pushing everything out. I just stole this from the spotter training talk, just so. But just to give you the idea that the shear is everything on the hail. The hail may still form up there, but if it has to come back down through the warm-up draft, it's going to underperform. Hail will overperform with the mesocyclones. And so if you're trying to guess hail sizes, I like this Kavanaugh and Schultz study. I thought was a pretty good one, especially since it validated the numbers that I like, and you always drift towards the studies that validate the numbers you liked. I like 60 dBZ to the minus 20 as the beginning of a severe thunderstorm warning, plus or minus those other factors. If the shear is less than 15 knots, then better not. If there's a mesocyclone in it, better go quicker than that. But I think this is a good study. They did a lot of cases in the southern plains that they sorted through and did several things with them. Just real quick on downbursts, you guys all know all this stuff, but from the standpoint is that when a downburst happens, the highest velocities are going to be in the lowest 300 or 400 feet, stuff you're not going to see on the radar at any distance away from the radar. So don't expect to see in a summertime July downburst case and like, oh, I only sampled 30, 35 knots. Well, the peak wind was actually down at 400 or 500 feet, where you couldn't get a good look at it. The only thing you might have a shot at is the mid altitude radial convergence aloft, where as the downdraft comes down, you're getting convergence maybe at 8, 9, 10,000 feet as air funnels into the downdraft and then spreads back out. I've seen that before, but you better be fast, because that's on the orders of minutes before the wind hits the ground. Again, it's not going to typically give you a lot of lead time, but at least it helps you understand the reports you might be getting. Landspout stuff, the mesonet might be the best warning tool you have for a landspout, because you know it's not mesocyclone driven, it's on a boundary, you've got opposing wind flow. If we start getting reports of a tornado that I suspect is a landspout, first thing I do is run to the mesonet. And if I got a boundary that shows me southeast winds up against northwest winds, something opposing each other, I'm gonna lean towards the idea that, hey, there's probably something there. And three calls in 90 seconds is a bad thing, because everybody's starting to call it in. But basically, do you have an updraft on a local shear that could be stretched? And the best way of knowing that is to go look at the surface data and try to figure that out. This is the last stuff. Just to know what you're warning for, and then warn or not. The worst thing in the world is to not have some idea of what is important to you, and to sit down there and try to be flexible. Kind of know in your mind, this is what I'm going to warn for, and then do it. And you'll be right 90% of the time. And those times that you're not right, adjust and learn from that. But if you know what it is, you'll be well served, and you'll be consistent, and you'll be scientific, and you'll have nothing to be ashamed of. Instead of you're just suddenly playing whack-a-mole now with the radar, like no one feels good after that, because you don't know really why you were making the decisions that you did. And I've talked to you about this before. Noisy cockpits are good. Asking for input. You don't always know everything that there is to know about the storms, and the biggest thing on there, the hardest thing to do, is not warn. If you've got a mesocyclone approaching Oklahoma City, and it's kind of marginal, and everything's kind of marginal, that the easiest thing in the world to do is issue a tornado warning, let all the stomach acid drain back out. You're good now. If you're covered, hey, and if you didn't get it, well, you know, the weather's kind of hard to forecast. It's kind of unpredictable. This is inexact science. You can go through all that routine. The hardest thing to be a truly good warning forecaster is to sit there and go, not yet. Not yet. I don't think so. I don't think it's quite right yet. And you look at that, and you really have to balance that from better safe than sorry. You know, you can always get the argument that, well, better safe than sorry. And that better safe than sorry is exactly right on any given day. But if it was good on Monday, is it just as good on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday? After you added up your last 10 better safe than sorries, and you've issued warnings very liberally, then you're in the stake of like, okay, maybe I need to reassess some. So it's just really a tough balance. It's great that you guys have a chance to work with the folks here that are actually operational in the actual warning and forecast world. And this is a great class, and I always appreciate Dr. Cohen for allowing me to come down and say hi to you guys for a little bit.